Foi-se o tempo em que a economia internacional se movia por cartas de crédito ou ordens de pagamento enviadas por correio. Hoje, na economia globalizada e informatizada, trilhões de dólares mudam de conta e de país com o apertar de uma tecla de computador. Operações financeiras tornam-se mais complexas a cada dia e seu alcance é internacional. No meio desse tornado de operações instantâneas pelo mundo, quando o capital corre mais rápido que seus controladores, como aplicar impostos? Os impostos e a ciranda financeira mundial são a preocupação e o foco de pesquisas do britânico Richard Murphy, que o Milênio entrevistou em Londres. Contador por formação e militante anti-evasão fiscal por escolha, Murphy tenta mostrar em livros, estudos, artigos, conferências e entrevistas o dano provocado pela sonegação de impostos, inclusive via uso dos chamados paraísos fiscais, que ele combate.
One of the basic principles of taxation is obviously that you take more from those who have more. They earn more and they pay more. And the fund goes into a common fund for the benefit of all society. But that doesn't seem to be working, is it?
In 1776, the first real economist, Adam Smith, laid down the basic principles of a tax system. He said the first principle was equity, fairness. Now, people interpret fairness in their own way. Most people, most of the time, have seen that to be your capacity to pay the tax. Can you afford to pay? And that's a measure of the more money you've got, the more tax you can pay. Not just in one level, but absolutely in tax rates. So that's the way it should work. Does it actually work out like that? All the evidence is that in many countries in the world, the people who pay the highest rates of tax, I mean the highest overall rates of tax, are the poorest in those communities. That's true here in the UK.
That's because the rich manage to find ways of not paying enough.
Well, there are several reasons why that happens. One is that we have some very unfair taxes. For example, VATs, GSTs, they're called different things around the world, sales taxes, hit the poorest hard, and they've become very popular over the last 20 to 30 years. And even when we have progressive tax systems, higher tax rates, the wealthiest know how to claim the most deductions, they know how to shift their income the most, they can afford the best accountants and lawyers, they end up paying the least.
One of the things that the big companies do is they treat tax as costs. That's a standard accounting procedure. You don't think that's fair?
I think that's not only not fair, I think it's fundamentally wrong. And I can show the evidence that that's wrong. On a standard set of accounts laid out in the way that most accountants produce them around the world, you strike your figure of profit before tax. That's the money you've made from undertaking your activities during this year. Remember, I'm an accountant. Then you do two things. You pay out dividends to shareholders and you pay tax to society. They combined are the stakeholders in this business. They are the people who have interest in it. The government provides, the community provides the resources which allow that business to operate. That payment isn't of tax, isn't a cost. It's a return to the society in which the company operates, a payment for the use of the resources that it has within that society. No, that's no cost. That's an obligation.
If you take a government like the current American government under George Bush, a Republican government, it is inspired by a principle which they call trickle-down economics. It was even adopted by Ronald Reagan before that. And the whole idea is if you allow the rich people to have more money, if you don't tax them enough, that extra money they will spend, they will invest, and therefore benefit the rest of society, including the poor people. Trickle-down, as they say. Is that reality or fantasy?
It's completely untrue. There's a great term for that just been invented in the UK by a chap called Oliver James. He calls it selfish capitalism. And I think that's a very good term. Because the reality is that that policy, invented in the 1970s by the Chicago School of Economists, has meant that actually wealth has not trickled down, it's not even trickled up, it's flooded up, so that the poorest in the world have had their incomes stay static or fall, and the richest have got richer and richer and richer. In America alone, real earnings for the average guy have stayed absolutely flat since the 1970s. They've seen no real increase. The wealthiest have just got richer and richer and richer. This was an economic policy designed by the rich for the benefit of the rich.
Through taxes.
And taxes, quite clearly, were one of the major ways to achieve this. Bush is the perfect example. He has cut all the taxes that will fall upon wealthiest America most. What he calls the death tax, an inheritance tax, is not a death tax, but we'll ignore that. Those taxes, the taxes on capital gains, the taxes on investment income, all the things that the wealthiest have, he's cut those. For the ordinary guy, they've stayed the same.
When you have countries with different levels of taxation, multinational companies and multinational individuals, very rich people, they have ways of benefiting from that, and they can somehow arrange their taxation to be based in the country that will benefit them more, will tax them less. Some Swedish companies even try to move their headquarters to London so they wouldn't pay as much tax as they do in Sweden. How can you fight that kind of thing?
Let's be clear that we have a problem with governments on this issue, because the differences in the tax rates, Ireland's low corporation tax rate, is a deliberate ruse to bring companies into Ireland who actually don't really make very much money in Ireland at all. Microsoft is the perfect example. Google is another one. I've looked at their accounts. They have employees there, but in proportion to their worldwide income, a fairly small number of employees there, but enormous rates of profit being declared there. So what we have is a situation that I call profit laundering. Profit laundering means you are moving your profits from one location to another location to find the lowest rate of tax that you can get. It's legal in most cases, but sure, it's antisocial because you're not paying tax where it's arisen. How can you deal with that? Got to remember how this tax system arose. The international tax architecture we've got now was created by the League of Nations in the 1930s. Now, the League of Nations was the precursor, the predecessor of the United Nations. It existed between the First World War and the Second World War. And it set up this system in the 1930s when there were steamships, no aircraft, transport was difficult, multinational companies were rare. And they thought where they'd respect the state as being the most important person. Now we have companies that can choose where they want to go, and they can get there easily. They don't even have to go there. They can run their operations in places like Ireland simply from a computer terminal. So we have to change our logic. We have to look at systems which say, we tax you where your customers are, where you make your sales, in other words, where your people are, where you have your employees, where you have your physical assets. Now, there is a system of tax that does that. It's called unitary taxation. You apportion the profits across a group on the basis of those three items. And Europe, for example, is looking at using that now as a way of overcoming this problem of artificially redistributing profits with inside the European Union to the lowest tax state. They call it the Common Consolidated Corporation Tax Base. If they produce those rules and all the company's sales are really in France and all its people are really in Germany, but it claims it's headquartered in Ireland, they'll say, we don't care where you claim you're headquartered. We'll tax you where your people are, where your assets are, where your sales are. And then you'll pay tax where the economic substance of your transaction arises. That's what I'm interested in.
Isn't the nature of capital such that it's got its own dynamic and it's always managing to move ahead of the regulators?
Well, the nature that's going, what's happening here is that people are playing a game, and the system has let them play this game. It's a game using what I call secrecy spaces. And secrecy spaces are tax havens, and we might want to talk about tax havens where they manage to hide what they're doing. And even their accounts are secrecy spaces. When you pick up the set of accounts of a big corporation, those accounts only show its dealings with the outside world, outside the corporation. But amazingly, they might have thousands of companies inside the corporation, all of whom are trading with each other every day. That's where they do the reallocation of their profits. That's how they shift money around the world. And those accounts let them get away with hiding that stuff. So what we need is open accountability and transparency. Then capital is going to have a big problem with hiding. Right now, we let it hide. We've got to open up the world.
Let's deal with this, what you just mentioned, the tax havens, you know, what in a mistranslation is called, and in Brazil they call fiscal paradises. You know, mistranslated, but the expression remained. But you actually believe they're more like hell than paradise.
Oh, yeah. These places are more like hell because they are creating complete distortions in our world economy. If you have an efficient market system, and believe me, I want efficient market systems. I am a chartered accountant. I have run 10 companies. I'm committed to the market system. But the market system works, and all undergraduate economists will learn this, when you have free and open access to information, when everybody has access to capital on the same basis, when we have a level playing field. The whole purpose of the tax havens is to destroy free access to information, to give mobile capital in large companies or for wealthy people privileges that small, independent, local companies and people don't have. So it's about shifting the balance in favor of the rich away from the local and the poor. So this is about distorting the whole market.
When we think of these tax havens, you know, from the Bahamas or the Cayman Islands to the Channel Islands, Jersey, to the Pacific Islands, everywhere. They're about 70 plus.
Well, my latest survey actually is now suggesting over 90, believe it or not.
90 tax havens. Is there an estimate of how much money is sheltered in these places?
I've got two estimates I can give you. One I researched, and that was a calculation I did in 2005 based upon a lot of data which came from independent sources like Merrill Lynch, Capgemini, Boston Consulting Group, Bank of International Settlements. And I came up with a figure for financial assets offshore of 9.5 trillion. A trillion's got 12 noughts at the end of it. That's US dollars, 9.5. And then we added on an estimate of non-financial assets, property and so on held in trust. Paintings, heaven knows what else, held in trusts through offshore structures, and said 11.5 trillion. Now, the OECD, based in Paris, don't agree with that. And I've had these discussions with them. They say it's only 7 trillion. Okay, I say, and they're only talking financial assets. So, you know, we may be a couple of trillion out.
That's almost the gross national product of the USA.
That's a substantial amount of money. I estimate that the tax loss a year could be 255 billion. US dollars. That's five times the cost of achieving the UN's Millennium Development Goals. We could pay for more hospitals, we could pay more for more schools. All of these options are then available. We could invest in infrastructure. We could solve the environmental crisis of the world. There's enough money there to deal with global warming. All of those things are possible, but they're not happening because this money's being hidden away.
How is the money from Brazil ending up in offshore? This is not just individuals doing that. Some companies, multinational companies, mm-hmm. Is it trade? You know, how does the money go out there?
The biggest part of all the money that flows through the tax havens, the secret spaces, is actually commercial trade. It's where a company is basically shifting its profits to get its lowest overall tax bill that it can get away with. And the most common mechanism for doing that is something called transfer pricing abuse. Inside a multinational company with lots and lots of subsidiaries, they will sell to each other. There's no market mechanism for setting the price at which they sell to each other because they're owned by the same people.
You can under-invoice or over-invoice?
Precisely. Or you can set up a structure where you say, my trademark is owned in the British Virgin Islands. And every company in the group has to use the trademark on its letterhead, on its products, you name it, its advertising. And you'll pay a fee, 4 cents in the dollar, of sales that you make for the use of that logo. And it'll be paid to the British Virgin Islands, and there's no tax in the British Virgin Islands company. Now, that's a way of shifting profit. Now, these are the mechanisms that people are using to get the money out of countries where there is tax into places there isn't tax or where there's low tax. This is by far the biggest part of the problem.
Brazil at the moment has its foreign trade, imports and export, adding up to about $250 billion a year, buying and selling. Would you say that more than half of that ends up as you described, through this procedure in tax havens?
We know, because the OECD, who have the best statistics in the world, have told us that 60% of world trade is undertaken on an intra-group basis, inside companies rather than between companies. It's likely, as a result, that half at least of the money moving in and out of Brazil is subject to transfer pricing arrangements, all of which could be subject to some degree of scrutiny, all of which are open to abuse if the company wants to. It's a choice by the company. But if the company wants to abuse, the opportunity is there. And we've seen from some recent challenges in Brazil that some people are saying this does happen. In Brazil, the issue is with the Caribbean. There is undoubtedly a flow of funds from Brazil to the Caribbean tax havens where money is moving out of Brazil into other locations. Or money is moving out of Brazil into the Caribbean and coming straight back again, disguised as being something else. This is another aspect of the whole thing. It's called capital flight then. I am quite convinced that this has been a deliberate economic policy by the USA and the UK to support the existence of tax havens because they want the money to come out of the poorer countries of the world to maintain their economies. Let's be honest, the US has got a phenomenal balance of payments deficit. The UK has run a persistent balance of payments deficit since 1996. We're always in the red. How can we support our economies? By other people giving them, us their money.
So the money goes out of a trade operation, goes offshore, and obviously it doesn't stay there, just sitting there. It has to be invested somewhere, and it's not invested back in the poor country where it originated. It's invested in the rich country.
There's two things that happen. If we're talking about the multinational corporations, the money does not normally go back into the local economy. The only reason why it would leave and go back is if there were incentives given under the local tax code to encourage new investment from outside the country. The moment you have incentives given to bring money back in again, there's an incentive to take your money out, turn it round through a tax haven, and bring it back in again. That's called round-tripping, and we know that's common. That's why there are so many Latin American banks in the Caribbean. They are assisting the process, I'm sure, of round-tripping. The money goes to there, comes back in, and gets investment incentives on its return. Inside the multinational corporations, the money goes out to the Caribbean. Let's be clear what happens in a tax haven. Nothing happens in a tax haven.
The tax haven, your money just sleeps there comfortably.
It doesn't even sleep there. The money is simply booked there. So we send an invoice from the Cayman Islands to Brazil for services supplied. Brazil pays to the Cayman Islands. There's no use for money in the Cayman Islands. There's only 27,000 people there. That money immediately leaves the Cayman Islands and goes somewhere else.
It's just an accounting procedure.
It's purely an accounting procedure. That company in the Cayman Islands may have no employees, may just have a bank account and a computer ledger somewhere to record what it's doing. The money moves straight on back into one of the major financial centres of the world, probably London or New York, but it could be Frankfurt, it could be Switzerland or wherever. So the money flows on. It isn't invested in these places. They are empty shells. They aren't real. You have to understand that.
As you said, there are more than 90 offshore centres. What can you do? Can you close them all? Because if you don't close all of them...
We can't close the offshore financial centres. They are, in some cases, independent, sovereign states. So we don't have the option of telling them, close down. What we have got the option of doing is forcing transparency upon them. And there are two ways of doing that. One is to say, we won't play ball with you unless you play ball with us. In other words, we want information from you. We will give you favours in exchange for that information. So we effectively buy their open disclosure of information on who's there, who's paying tax there, who's not paying tax there, and so on. That's information exchange. And that's one way of dealing with them. The second way of dealing with this issue is actually to force the multinational companies who are the biggest culprits in this process. You know, I'm not excusing those who use them for criminal activity. That's another massive issue altogether. But let's talk about the biggest abuses. The people who are helping the money move offshore are the banks and the multinational corporations who are running these operations, the accountants and lawyers who support them. What we have to do is blow that world apart by requiring these corporations to be open and accountable. We could do that. We have written the mechanism to do that. It's called country-by-country reporting within the corporate accounts of multinational corporations. All we're asking those companies to do is when they publish their global accounts, we want them to say, in which countries do you operate? Without exception, every single location. The moment you know that the whole of this operation is based in a tax haven, or is using it in a big way, their share valuations, for a start, will go down enormously. People don't trust tax haven operating companies. Enron is not a good precedent. It ran 900 companies offshore.
To what extent do you think this system that you describe, with all its faults, has played a role in the current international financial crisis we're going through that is, you know, leading to banks failing, recession, and all that? How do you relate the two?
Utterly interlinked with each other. We have the whole problem of the subprime crisis, the whole problem of off-balance sheet finance, the whole problem of what is called special investment vehicles, SIVs and SPVs, special purpose vehicles and so on. All of these are fundamentally secretive ways of moving money around. Off-balance sheet finance sounds remarkably like offshore finance, and they are both heavily related. Most of these off-balance sheet vehicles are located in tax havens. Jersey, Guernsey, Alaman, Cayman, Bermuda, they're all used for this sort of purpose. And they are part of this fantasy world that has been created where regulation is lax, accountability is low, people have turned a blind eye. And now that's coming home to roost, because what we realize is nobody knows what's in these special purpose vehicles. And we get a subprime crisis because suddenly people realize these investments, which are supposedly AAA rated, the best things you can buy, are actually full of mortgages which nobody's ever going to repay. And yet, we didn't know that because they were repackaged through locations where accountability was low.
Do you think there is a realistic chance of approving these measures that will require more transparency from these companies and therefore more accountability?
Yes, is my straightforward answer. I guess I wouldn't be doing what I do if I didn't believe that. But I will take two signs of optimism. One is that I was the first person to write about country by country reporting and, in a sense, created the concept. Last November, the European Parliament got as far as asking the International Accounting Standards Board, the body who makes the rules for accountancy reporting around the world effectively, to create such a standard. Only for the extractive industries at the moment, mining, oil, and so on. But even so, we've got to the point where a major parliament has said, we want this. We think the case is proven that we need to know about this. And then I look to America, and I look at Barack Obama standing for president. He may or may not get it. We don't know at the time of recording. But what we do know is that he's put his name to something called the Stop Tax Havens Abuse Act, which is actually going to try and tackle abuse in 34 of the biggest tax havens in the world. We've got major political figures now. Major parliaments are saying, enough is enough. We want openness, transparency, and accountability because we want fair markets. Nobody can say that Barack Obama is opposed to markets. Nobody can say the European Union is opposed to fair markets. But we do want level playing fields, openness, and accountability. That way, we aren't subject to the shocks which otherwise we've seen can be imposed upon us by the way the markets work.
Pleasure.
And mine as much.